I still can hardly believe it, she says. I, with shriveled, bent fingers, atrophied muscles, gnawed nails, and no feeling from the shoulders down, will one day have a new body, light, bright, and clothed in righteousness, powerful and dazzling.
Amen.
She says, I still cannot believe it, that one day I'm going to have a new body that is powerful, dazzling, that is perfect in the image of my Savior.
Amen.
Can you imagine, she says, the hope that gives someone spinal cord injured like me, or someone who has cerebral palsy, brain injured, who has multiple sclerosis. Imagine the hope this gives someone who is manic depressive. No other religion, no other philosophy promises new hearts, minds, and bodies. Only in the gospel of Christ, hallelujah, do hurting people find such incredible hope.
Hallelujah.
Many times as a pastor, even just a few years ago, one of my friends was in a car accident, paralyzed from the waist down, confined to a wheelchair for the rest of his life, a gifted worship leader in church. I don't have answers to why such things happen. You know what? When I talk to him, more than anything I can share with him is not some false hope that you will one day walk on the face of the earth, but the surety of the hope that one day you will walk again in the light of His glory as you worship your Creator in His presence. Your body will one day be transformed again. When we go through physical problems in our life, no other philosophy, no other religion can give hope like the Christian faith that tells you you will have a new heart, a new mind, and a new body. And then He tells you, today, you may not be paralyzed with a broken neck. Maybe you are paralyzed with other limitations in your life. You may have a broken heart, a broken home, a broken reputation. She says, these things that presently scream for your undivided attention may close the doors to earthly satisfaction, but they will swing windows wide open with the spirited hope of heaven. I don't know how you came here tonight, or what problems you came here tonight with. I'm going to tell you, whether you've been letting depression, anxiety, a broken heart, a broken home, broken relationship define you, I'm here to tell you that God, there is hope to be found in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. He can make you well, and even if everything is not well on the face of the earth, there is eternal hope to be found in the fact that we will one day share with Him in His glory. That's why in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16 through 18, the Apostle Paul writes like this, therefore, we do not lose heart. You know why? Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. Do you know that? Even those of you who are living in your 20s and 30s, every day outwardly, you're wasting away. But the Christian can say, inwardly, I'm being renewed day by day. Oh, for a light and momentary. You know that? Any suffering that you go through on the face of the earth are light. They are momentary. Look at the other side. Are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. Paul is saying, put all your suffering on one end of the balance. Put the weight of eternal glory on the other side, and that is always going to outshine and be heavier than any light and momentary struggles that you have on the face of the earth. And so he says, so we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. We as human beings have a tendency to define our life by what we see around us and the circumstances of life. Today God is asking you to look beyond the circumstances of life, to a home, an eternal home, eternal glory that Christ is preparing for you. And suddenly, oh hallelujah, all the things on earth, hallelujah. That's why the hymn writer says, fix your eyes on Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. Fix your eyes on Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. Paul writes and says, we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. You know why? He says, what is seen is temporary, but what is seen is eternal. What is seen is temporary. What is unseen is eternal. You will not always cry. You will not always have an eye where tears are being shed. One day, He will wipe away all tears from your eyes. Amen. Today, you might be sitting here with mental problems that no one can diagnose or no one can fix. I'm here to tell you, there is a day that is coming when everything will be all right, and He will wipe away all tears from our eyes and make us new again. As the worship team comes forward, the reason I share this with you tonight as we talk about discipleship is, it is very important, let's stand in the presence of God, that you and I understand where we are, who we are today, and where we are going. Then only will you follow Him with all your heart. It is that grateful heart that never forgets the fact that God saved me, a wretched being. Not only did He save me, but He made me a child of God. And He gave me inheritance that the world could never give to me. Not only just any inheritance, I'm a co-heir with Christ. And even if I go through any suffering in my life, oh, I'm only becoming more and more like Him. And one day I'm going to share in His glory forever and ever.
Amen.
Can you believe tonight that God knows what He's doing with your life? Can we believe tonight that more than us, He knows what He's doing? What right does the clay have to ask the potter, why do you make me like this? Oh, but He knows exactly what He's doing with my life and your life. You know, as a child of the Heavenly Father, I need to rest upon the fact that my Heavenly Father knows what is best for my life. He made me very, very uniquely. The Bible reminds me that even before the foundation of the earth was laid, He saw me. And even before I was formed in my mother's womb,
hallelujah,
my unformed being, oh, His eyes saw me. And not only did He create me in His own image, in His everlasting grace, like I was a child who was abandoned in the field, He came and told me to live by His Spirit, gave me His Holy Spirit that lives inside of me, that makes me a living being. Oh, not only that, along with that, He gave me everything that belongs to the Father's house. Maybe you've been running away from this Father. Maybe you've heard about this all your life, but never really fully realized what this grace is all about. Just like the prodigal son, you took the Father for granted and His blessings for granted. You ran away from His house. You squandered and wasted everything away. But you know what the good news is? My Heavenly Father is not like the fathers of this world, who sometimes find it difficult to forgive and forget. When He sees His son coming back home, even from a faraway distance, oh, He does not care about who is making fun of Him. He runs towards that son. He takes him into His arms as if He had done nothing wrong. He brings him back to the Father's house. He gives him a garment, and He puts a ring on his fingers, and He makes him, welcomes him as if he's never left the home. That is the love of the Heavenly Father. Maybe you came here tonight questioning the goodness of God. God, I served you faithfully, but why are all these things happening in my life? I prayed for this for many, many years. Why are there not answers that I'm looking for? I'm here to assure you tonight that there's a God in heaven who cares about you more than you care for yourself, who loves you with an everlasting love, and He continues to love you. Will you trust in His goodness today? If you need prayer tonight, I'm going to ask you to come forward, and we as servants of God will pray for you. I don't care what it is. I don't care what the need of your heart is. God is laying on your heart that, no, I need prayer. I need more of God's grace in my life and awareness of it, to know that I'm His child and He is my Father. I need that confidence in my life. Maybe you've been running away from Him. You're saying, I want to once again come back to Him. I want to once again experience that love. I want it to overtake my life. Guide the way I walk. Guide the way I pray. Guide the way I worship. Guide the way I follow after Him, because I understand what He's done for me. God is coming into your heart tonight. Tonight you can come forward as well. As we sing, oh praise the name of the Lord our God. I cast my mind to Calvary. It is where Calvary, where your sins were taken away. It is at Calvary that you became a child of God. It is at Calvary that everything that belonged to the Father became your inheritance. Will you praise Him tonight, as the songwriter says, oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Let's continue to worship Him tonight. Praise God.
It is this way.
who died on the cross that we might become children of God. What great salvation! How undeserving we are, yet in your infinite love, when we were pity, when we were not worthy of any mercy,
hallelujah,
you came, you died, you rose again, and today you are interceding on the right hand of the Father for me, that I come to you with boldness, oh, not with the spirit of fear, crying out, Abba, Father, for we have been given the gift of sonship. We praise you, God, for the unsearchable riches that we have found in the Lord Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
Lord, I pray for every single person that is here tonight. I pray that you bless them, O Lord, as they depart from this place. I pray that you will fill them with the overflowing joy and the confidence of knowing who they are in Christ. May they live their life with confidence. May they live their life with authority. May they live with a life with purpose, knowing who they are, what they're saved from, and where they're going. Lord, we come in this church, pastor in your mighty hands. Lord, we thank you for this time. Thank you for the worship team. Thank you for speaking to us from God's word. In the name of the Lord Jesus that we pray.
Amen.